Aisha, thank you for joining us today. My name is Beverly and I'm a volunteer with One Future Collective's COVID-19 Mental Health Rehabilitation Project. We're so happy to have you with us today, Aisha. Aisha is a psychotherapist from Mumbai, and she will be talking to us about her experiences in the current climate of the COVID-19 crisis in India. So let's begin. Tell us something more about yourself and the work you've been doing.
I am currently a counseling psychologist, a psychotherapist, and for the past year, I've been involved in two ways, in the mental health arena. In one, I was part of a mental health counseling organization, a helpline, mental health helpline, that set up several helplines during the pandemic for frontline workers, for psychosocial counseling, and I was the senior programs and research officer. And in the second half of it, I have my own private practice, and where I do one-on-one and group work, essentially.
All right, thank you. So what has this past year been like for you?
It's been overwhelming, exhausting, deeply transformative, I think, personally, and just a non-stop blur. I can't tell anything except pre-pandemic and now, like most of us, I think. So yes, I think that's about that how true. It is.
That is true. We are living through a mental health crisis. So is there some sort of pattern you've been seeing in mental health concerns?
In whatever capacity, I don't think that there is anybody who's not impacted. And so it's not a question of whether or not there is a mental health concern now, but to what extent, actually. We're actually living through a global phenomenon. And I think in whatever position that you hold in society, maybe if you're privileged, you're less impacted. But everybody, right, from children to the poor to the rich, everybody has been impacted either in small or in big ways. And the pattern that I've seen is that there is just a huge boom in the number of people who've recognized the need to seek help at this time, which is a great win, I think, because if you're able to recognize that you need help and you're reaching out to people, that in itself is a step towards collective healing. That in itself is a step towards taking care of yourself and the people around you. But the pattern would be, I think, given the situation, and every mental health concern is psychosocial in my understanding, there's been immense stress caused by job instability. We don't know if we're going to have to have the same job in the next 2 months. There's massive layoffs happening. People are stuck in cities where they're faced with immense isolation and loneliness. We are impacted, of course, by the pandemic and the virus, and we don't know if we will receive the kind of help that is required. People, women, people from marginalized communities and identities are at such a high risk of facing violence at home, and we're all stuck in these kind of situations that are psychosocial in nature for sure. Also, personally, I think on a personal front, people have experienced lack of meaning, purposelessness, hopelessness. What am I doing here? I don't know if how to make sense of what's happening. And that's absolutely understandable, given that all of us, I don't think I was prepared, even in my training as a psychotherapist, to kind of address what is happening. I'm really at a loss, and as is everybody else in whatever capacity. If we talk about specific, kind of demographics, privilege is at play. We know that. And individuals with more privilege are less impacted, and individuals with less privilege are immensely impacted. And I think that's the kind of pattern that we're seeing again. The pattern is of anxiety, depression, lack of meaning, immense grief and loss, pain, suffering. And we're witnessing trauma collectively, in a way that we've never ever had to do before.
Right. So Aisha, what are some of the reasons you feel, for which people are hesitant to seek mental health support?
One, I think, like you mentioned, are, actual constraints on time and the kind of work that people are doing, especially with frontline workers, like you said, that if there are shifts that are continuous, you know, if there is no time to actually seek help and a professional support, sometimes therapy fees is not very affordable and economical. So all of these kind of things are ideas that sometimes people have that make them hesitant to seek help. And the second thing is that, you know, there are very many alternate ways that therapy is now, alternate forms of therapy, whether it's helpline phone counseling, whether it is accessing support groups, whether it is having access to a repository of therapists who are actually providing pro bono therapy. I think there is that gap systemically between there being these resources and people knowing about them. So I think these are a couple of reasons. And to think, you know, the stigma that is anyway attached to mental health, that main kamzor thodi na hu. It doesn't make sense for me to seek mental health help. I'm not crazy, or, you know, it's not that bad yet. And yet we know that people are going through burnout and, you know, anxiety, depression, stress at work, especially frontliners, whether it is, you know, a delivery person, whether it is a lab technician, whether it is a nurse, whether it is a peon, whether it is support staff, anybody who's involved in that pipeline of essential, you know, the final product is not the doctor in the hospital. It is all the people who are kind of relaying all the resources that need to reach him also. Yeah, that's part of the hesitance.
All right.
One, seek help. I think as soon as you begin to consider it, is a great time to seek help. You know, there's no right time. But when you observe that your daily functioning is impacted, you know, the things that that are most basic in taking care of ourselves, eating well, resting for an appropriate amount of time, waking up rested, and eating, sleeping, and kind of connecting with people, you know. If all these things become difficult, taking care of our personal hygiene, if these are able to kind of contribute at work and be present and do the things that we were usually able to do, we had interest in doing, I think that's a sign that it might be very difficult to seek therapy at that time. But at the same time, you know, you don't have to have your everyday functioning impacted to be able to seek it. Sometimes we seek it just to understand our experiences better, you know, to have a greater insight into how can I cope with what's happening. Although I am coping, you know, how can I support myself better in my journey?
Definitely. So, Aisha, what can people do to cope with collective grief?
What can we do? We can just hold on, I think, for the moment. You know, these are abnormal circumstances by every single measure. And we've never seen anything like this. I don't think any professional training, any psychotherapist was prepared to address this also. But I think the only way to kind of cope with collective trauma is collective resilience. And what I mean by that is, one, to know that we are not alone in our experience. Okay. I think all of us in whatever, I think even personally, many psychotherapists, while helping other people, have faced immense loss, have been through the same experiences that they're helping other people through, you know, and to know that I'm not alone in this was a deeply relieving thing for me and for many other people who have been part of, say, support groups, or who have reached out to other people and we found a collective vocabulary to say, oh my God, this is so terrible and I don't know how to cope with it. How are you coping with it? You know, so that's what I mean by collective resilience, is that we have the opportunity to air what we're feeling about it. We have words to talk about what it means. We have a collective understanding of, okay, you're going through a similar experience as me, and how can I extend compassion and empathy and understanding, whether it's in the workspace that, you know, somebody has been impacted by COVID and you give them 2 weeks off and then that's it, versus, okay, do you need more support? Are you recovering well? You know, or, you know, kind of helping them to not sanitize their identity in the sense that I can't just come to the screen because I have a laptop. There are 100 other things I have to take care of. you know. So in that way, that's the kind of collective resilience that we're talking about. To share and to know that you're not alone in this experience. There are people who are going through very similar kind of feelings as you. And we're all in this together, actually. Because there's no other way out of it. If you saw the kind of, you know, heartwarming things that were happening on social media, when we felt like our systems were not equipped to deal with what was happening, people were reaching out and helping people they had never met, spoken to, had nothing to do with in a remote state and city somewhere else.
So true. Strangers coming together. Strangers coming together.
Yeah. That is collective resilience also. You know, I think when you're talking about the pandemic being as dreary as it has been, there have also been these moments of, you know, pure human brotherhood, you know. There's no way out of this except to be with each other, whether it is me as a helping professional, whether it is you as a neighbor, whether it is you as a citizen.
Correct. Would you like to share any heartwarming moments you might have experienced?
I ran about 3 support groups during this, you know, during the second lockdown. And it was beautiful to just be there. Because as a facilitator also, I mean, I just kind of held space, right? But the kind of interactions that people had in extending and receiving support both were, again, you know, a return to that basic human nature of helping and being helped. And to know we're not alone. And I think, you know, whether it was outside of the group, when group ended and people kind of made connections among themselves, or whether it was within group, that you said something that I really needed to hear today, you know? And I think in the whole storm of things that we can't control, if this is the one thing that I hear and it makes my day, I think just to be witness to that was very, very touching. Because you never know who might be going through the same thing, what my sharing might bring, what I may hear that I needed to hear, what kind of help somebody else may be able to provide, absolutely coincidentally. There's no rhyme or reason or explanation. And for me to see that was very touching, not just in the support groups, like I mentioned, on social media, within friends. You know, people were really extending themselves. I think even at One Future Collective, if you were volunteering to do the things that you were doing, you know, kind of connecting people where they needed to be connected to funds, resources, pro bono therapists, X, Y, Z. All of this is building that resilience that I'm talking about.
Absolutely. In fact, I attended one of the community spaces by One Future Collective, and that was really therapeutic for me. It was a space from 8 to 9 o'clock in the night, and we just, you know, the facilitator really gave us the space to just be, and it was really helpful. And I hope more people reach out to us and to other organizations to seek the help that they need, because they might not reach out now, but they could always, maybe they will reach out in the future, and as the numbers go down, the situation gets better. Aisha, what has changed for you over the past year, the first wave versus the current wave? What would you say has changed?
I would say in the first wave, the focus was on the novelty of what was happening. And we did not know the extent of things. Whereas in the second wave, I would say we really became familiar up close with the extent of the damage that it could cause. In the first wave, we were trying to kind of figure out how to coexist. And now that we found a way, you know, whether it was in the form of masks, or whether it was social distancing, all these kind of quarantine and lockdown and all of that. In the second wave, we really, you know, with the second mutation, we saw how fatal it is. And I think all of us indirectly or directly have witnessed the loss of life, which for me personally was, you know, very different. I've never in my life had to see so much death so close, you know, and not just mine, but the people that I work with, but the news, you know, and community. And it was just absolutely heartbreaking. So I think to come to terms with that, no matter how much kind of inner work you do, this is too much in too little time.
Right. right, Aisha, and as you devote your time and energy to others by offering mental health support, what are the little things that you do to manage self-care in the middle of it all?
Therapy. I go to therapy. And I think that's the space to be, because it's just a regular engagement with myself, especially when I am processing so much at work, as all of us are in whatever professions we are in, to have a space where I can be instead of do. And I think that's the difference between doing and being, is that, you know, even when you're living at home, you may not completely express to the people that are living with how annoyed you are, how exhausted you are, because you're always task oriented. Now I've finished working, now I have to make food. Do you want food? I have to sleep, now I have to rest. But when you're given a free space, like you said, you know, with your meeting also, when there was just a free space to be, is when all this inner content has an outlet, there's a pore. And for me, I think that space is invaluable. I try not to miss it at any cost. I may have missed only two or three, but that has been a very important space to me since last year. And second is supervision, especially in my work, for me to be able to help people as I need to. I need to have a kind of place where I can think through how best I can do that. And sometimes, like I said, you know, we're not prepared for this. So we're all just going with what we know from previous knowledge. This is new. And to have a space to think about, is this helpful in the way that it has to be? These two things. Connecting with my friends. I think technology has been indispensable. I was very much into Ludo last year. And, you know, finding more recently, I've taken up a singing class, which has been a welcome change. You know, I'm learning something. So it's a different role and smaller things like this.
Wonderful. I feel like we're really harnessing technology, and we seem to be doing more classes than we've ever done.
I think before. I've done more trainings, more workshops, more learning in the past year than I was ever able to do in the, you know, 5 years before that. It's really made
technology is so helpful at this time. Number one, we cannot, of course, it's social distancing, but it makes therapy more accessible in a way. If someone doesn't have the time for a one-on-one, they might find this easier, or maybe just not being face-to-face physically, you know, they might find it more approachable. What are your thoughts on that?
Most definitely. I think technology has been a boon, you know, because the number of people that reach out now, I may not have taken up or been working with any of these people had it not been for technology. They're not in the same state. Some of them are not in the same city. Some of them are not in the same country. And yet to be connected in that way, where I'm able to provide something and somebody they're seeking that help, has been very interesting actually. Because if, like I said, there was that traditional kind of idea of therapy where you go to a space and it has to be in your locality and it has to be X, Y, Z, all of that is suddenly taken away, and it comes down to the basics about there being a professional and there being a person who's seeking that, you know, right. And that's about it. There's nothing else that's required except a laptop and internet connection. And
I'm glad that mental health support is not just having a moment. It is going to, it's definitely
movement.
Yeah, it's a movement. Wonderfully put. Wonderfully put. Aisha, you worked with a team to help set up a COVID helpline. Was this last year, this year? Can you take us through that, please?
Yes. I was part of a team of a mental health helpline that set up a psychosocial and counseling helpline for frontline workers. And we received an immense response, I think, at the time that I was working there, from the frontline workers. But of course, it was very difficult to kind of get them to take notice of it. Like we said, you know, sometimes it is the timing, sometimes it is lack of knowledge about what therapy actually is. And in the middle of the pandemic, you know, when this novel situation has come up, for us to even educate or have those avenues available, I think would have been immensely helpful for frontliners in whatever capacity, because it was a multilingual, and it's not just, mental health is always psychosocial. You know, what is happening in the societal backdrop of our life, whether it is job, whether it is oppression, whether it is lack of resources and access, whether it is my identities and what they mean. All of this has a very deep impact on the way that people experience what is happening also. You know, all of us may have gone through the same thing, but some of us had more access to resources. That if something went wrong, I'm sure that I can get a hospital bed, or I can get this so-and-so medicine. But there are some people who don't have that. And just to keep that in mind when we're thinking about also frontliners, that who are these people who have had to put themselves out there? You know, right. For some of them, it wasn't a choice. For some of them, it was a necessity. Ghar kaise chalega? So in that, there is that stress of the financial, there is the fear of contracting the virus, there is the fear of spreading it to the people that you live with, and of not knowing whether or not you will be helped. You know, kahan se aayenge paise agar kuch galat ho gaya, insurance hai ki nahi. All of these are systemic, they're not personal. So when any kind of work focuses only on, oh, what can you do to change how you think about that, it's putting the responsibility of systems on individuals, which may not be fair. And I think that's the most important thing to think about as we're moving through the pandemic also. That the more we're able to connect people, referral linkages, resources, what kind of help can they be given in actual real life that can improve their circumstances, rather than generic statements like, okay, accept what it is or change how you think about it. It's not going to help. You know, at the end of the day, you need certain things to survive, and you need help, support, and a free, equal space in society.
Right. This was so helpful. Thank you for articulating this so well. Thank you so much, Aisha, for being on our talk show. Thanks for taking the time out for this.
Thank you, Beverly, for having me.